in their life that they look up to. There's a person that has nurtured them and guided them and given them direction. And we should honor them all days. But especially on today, we honor mothers. And I won't be before you long, but today we're going to talk about mothers and how mothers are the stewards of God's gift within each and every one of us.
Amen.
Mothers, the stewards of God's gift within each and every one of us. Now, to define the term steward, we understand that a steward is a person who protects or is responsible for the investment in someone or the investment of others. So basically, stewards are put in place to oversee things of importance. It can be things that are within you, or it can be things that are within others around. But when a steward is in place, you understand that they are overseeing something of great importance. Mothers are stewards, and they oversee God's gift within us. Our scripture for today comes from Proverbs 22:6, which says, "Start children off on the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it." Many of us look at that, you know, as a promise, but really that's a warning and letting us know that start them off in the way that they should go, okay? Because you got to do it early so that when they're old, they won't turn from it. Mothers play a vital role in cultivating their children's talents and helping them discover their purpose. Okay, not only is your mother your first teacher, but your mother is your first best friend. Now, before we get any further in the message for today, I have a slideshow to share with you, okay? And this slideshow, we're going to take a look at some of the mothers of Cornerstone and those that are connected with Cornerstone as we just have a tribute to mothers here on Mother's Day. Amen. Give me the same effect. Thank you. Mothers here with us to celebrate today, and all of those that we'll always remember in our hearts and in our prayers and our thoughts, we say Happy Mother's Day. Amen. Now, the mother that we're speaking of today wasn't pictured in the slideshow, but that's nothing unusual because this mother didn't get much credit in the scriptures for what she did, but her work played a vital part in many things that took place throughout the biblical times. You see, the focus of today's message was Jochebed, okay? And Jochebed is the mother of Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. And she's the perfect example of a steward of God's gift. You see, her faith nurtured Moses to get to his destiny. Her faith. Because she was the steward over these children that God entrusted her with. nurtured Moses to his destiny. Jochebed uncovered and developed the potential of Moses as only a mother can do. Teachers will tell you setbacks. The community will tell you why you're not going to make it. But mama always sees the best within you. Nobody else may not be able to see it. Some people say he has a face only a mother could love. But a mother is a steward over the gift within each and every one of us. You see, Jochebed was the natural lighthouse that guided Moses toward his divine purpose until he reached the point where he could hear and understand from God for himself. Imagine if Jochebed would have been a different kind of mother. What if she would have been a modern day, independent, I can do it by myself mother? Do you think Moses would be the Moses that we read about in history?
No.
She was a lighthouse, and she was a steward of the gift. And she was so connected and in relationship with the Father that when the Father gave her the children, she saw the gift and she considered it an honor to cultivate the gift within these children. You see, she played a crucial role in the life of Moses, even though she's only mentioned in two verses of scripture by name. And both of those verses were simply genealogical listings. They just called her name because she fell in the genealogy. No big mention of what she did. And this woman was a steward over greatness. You see, Jochebed is proof to all mothers that you may not get the recognition for the work, but your work can birth greatness. She didn't worry about being written about in the newspaper. She didn't worry about going to Oprah's masterclass. She didn't worry about how many likes she had on Facebook. She didn't worry about how many other mothers in the community were envious of the work she did. She understood that her purpose was to birth and cultivate the greatness. So no matter what's going on in your life, and no matter what it is that you are facing, nobody may see that which you are doing. But just understand that what you are doing can birth a greatness. You see, she doesn't have a book in the Bible devoted to the work that she did. There's not proclamations from everyone to Jochebed. You hardly ever hear anyone call her name, but she was not just a regular woman. This woman gave birth to three leaders of the Exodus generation: Moses, Aaron, and Miriam. Accolades were due to her. But she did not receive them in the scripture. You see, Jochebed was favored by God for the spiritual work that she had to do. And that work led to a natural compensation. How many understand that we serve a God that always makes a way out of no way?
Yeah. Yeah.
She had a purpose. She had a calling. She had an opportunity. And she took that purpose and that opportunity, and she used that calling to do what God called her to do in the natural. So then in the spirit, God blessed her work and allowed her to receive compensation for doing what any mother would do.
Yes.
She raised and nurtured her child.
Yes.
But a way was made out of no way. You see, Jochebed taught Moses the same promises that her parents and grandparents taught her. She told him about the promises made to Abraham that were passed on to Isaac and later to Jacob. Jochebed hid Moses for the first 3 months of his life. She hid him. But she had faith that no one would find him. And then a day came when Jochebed took the infant and she put him into a little bassinet and she set him afloat in the Nile River. It wasn't the ark. It was a simple bassinet held together by pitch. And she took this baby, the same baby that she realized was a little different.
Yeah.
She took this baby, the same baby she realized had such a purpose that she hid him. She took this baby and put him into the Nile River. Understand, the Nile River wasn't like the ditch that runs outside by the highway. She put her baby into a river that was filled with current and the river had many natural predators into the river, but Jochebed, a woman that was a steward over the gifts of her child, placed her baby into the river. Now, I've said this many times before, we like to play checkers, but we serve a God that plays chess. When Jochebed took the baby and she put him into the Nile River, it was all a part of the plan. Because the baby made it from the river into the palace. Yes. Nobody but God.
Nobody.
The beauty of this all is, and then once the baby made it to the palace, the baby's birth mother, the one entrusted to care after him, the one that had the charge to steward over the gift in him, was selected to come into the palace and nurse and raise her baby. The baby that she let go. The baby that she let go in faith. The baby that she hid in faith. The baby that she saw the favor on his life. That she let go. I'm sure her natural instinct said, you'll never see this baby again. I'm sure there was a voice in the back of her mind that said, when you turn to walk away, this bassinet is going to sink and this baby is going to grow. I'm sure the thought crossed her mind. But she was a woman of faith. And God did for her what only he could do. He didn't just save the baby. He gave her the opportunity to see the baby, nurture the baby, and have relationships with the baby. Because that's the kind of God that we serve. He makes the way out of no way. He takes the crooked path and makes them straight. He takes the dark and he gives light. He takes the nothing and he makes something. That's the kind of God we serve. Who wouldn't want to serve a God like this?
Yes.
Now let's take a look at what's going on in the palace. Now, one of the babies that the Pharaoh was so angry that he wanted killed, one of the babies that the Pharaoh was so angry that he despised the sight of, is now right under his nose.
Yes.
He will prepare a table before you.
Yes.
In the presence of your enemies. Yes. The one that the Pharaoh wanted dead is now sitting at his dinner table. The one that the Pharaoh wanted dead is now receiving the provision that he provides for his children. The one that the Pharaoh wanted dead is right in his face.
Yes, right there.
He could have snapped his neck any day.
Yes.
But the favor of God said no.
Yes.
How many of you understand that you can feast in the presence of your enemy as long as God is the one? He prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemy. He didn't do it behind their back. He didn't do it after they'd gone. He didn't do it before they got there. He prepared the table in the presence of your enemy. Because what he's saying is, what are you going to do? Are you going to have faith in me? Or are you going to have fear for them? I brought you this far, and I didn't bring you this far to leave. How many times do you think Jochebed looked into the eyes of Moses and said to herself, my God, we're in the presence of the enemy.
Yes.
We ain't worrying. We ain't hiding. We ain't crying. We feasting in the presence of our enemies. That is the kind of God that we serve. Now today, I want to give you just a few points to help you understand how mothers are the stewards of the gift within the children. First thing you should always remember is Jochebed teaches mothers to choose faith over fear. If you don't get anything else from this today, Jochebed teaches mothers choose faith over fear. Now, considering the decree that all male children should be killed, can you imagine the anxiety that Jochebed faced as she carried this baby in her womb? The decree has been given, kill all male children. There were no ultrasounds in the day of Jochebed. There was a 50-50 chance you might have a boy, you might have a girl. You don't know what you're going to get, but there's a chance that this blessing that's growing within you. Every time she felt this baby kick, I wonder if she thought to herself, oh my Lord, as soon as I have this baby, they're going to kill it. I wonder what she worried about, but we understand that what Jochebed chose to do, she chose faith.
Right.
over fear. If God called me to it, God is going to see me through it. If God placed the table before me, I can feast and not worry because God is in the midst of this. So now the question that I pose to you today is, will you choose faith when the promise is under attack? Will you choose faith when the outcome looks dim? Will you choose faith when everything that you hope for seems as if it's about to be snatched away? That is why it's called faith, the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. If you can see it, it don't take anything. If you can do it in your own means, it don't take anything. It is faith because you got to trust that it's going to work out even though it looks like it's not going to work out. Your logic says you in trouble. But your faith says God has never left you or forsaken you. Your logic says that you are about to lose this baby. But your faith says if God called him, God is going to see him through until the perfect end. Hebrews 11 and 23 tells us, by faith, Moses' parents hid him 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child, and they were not afraid of the king's decree. By faith, not by their logic, not because they had a bunker where they could hide the baby, not because they were going to run away from the situation, but by faith. They saw that he wasn't an ordinary baby. They looked at him and they felt something. They remembered what was spoken to them, and they said, but in faith, we'll hide the baby until Jesus tells us different. Now, I know what the king said, but I know what my God. So they chose faith over fear. You see, because mothers see your purpose, and they will risk everything to protect you. You want a problem on your hands? Stand between a mother and the purpose of her children. The quiet, meek women suddenly are transformed into warriors. When you look at the pack of lions, everybody says the lion is the king of the jungle, but the female lion is the one that goes out on the hunt. The female lion is the one that goes out for the kill. The female lion is the one that brings the food back for home. Do not stand between a woman and the purpose of her children. You see, there was nothing ordinary about Moses. But likewise, there was nothing ordinary about the faith of his parents or the power of their God. Always choose faith over fear. The second thing that Jochebed wants us to understand is Jochebed teaches mothers to trust God daily. Yes. You got to trust him. Yes. New day, new mercy. Yes. New situation, but same God. You've never been here before. You've never done this thing before. He may not equip you for it, but if he called you to it, he'll get you through it. He'll make a way out of no way. But you've got to trust God daily. You see, scripture tells us that Jochebed hid Moses for 3 months. Brand new baby. Doesn't know anything about the world that he's in. We all know that newborn babies are crying babies. There was a decree to kill the male children. Jochebed had a male son. And Jochebed said, we can hide this baby and there's nothing to worry about. Not because she was a professional at hiding, but she was a woman of faith. Yeah. She knew if the baby cried, nobody was going to hear it. She knew if they came looking, they weren't going to find him because she trusted God daily. Amen. Maybe the soldiers walked past their house many a time during the day, listening and looking for babies. Jochebed had no worries because she trusted God daily. She saw what was before her, but she also knew the power of that which dwelt richly within her. She had no fear. When she saw the soldiers, she trusted. When the baby cried out loud, she trusted. She didn't worry about Miriam and Aaron going to school and telling everybody, my mama got a newborn son. She had no worries and she had no fear because she trusted God daily. You see, and that's what we got to do as we go through the situations of life. We got to trust God daily. Don't make the profession on Sunday and let it wear off by Wednesday. Yes. Trust God daily. New day, opportunity.
Yes.
Continue to trust God and watch that he'll make a way out of no way. You see, this is what we call a moment by moment trust. She didn't know what was going to happen next. She didn't know who she was going to run into. She didn't know how this was all going to turn out precisely. She didn't know the details, but she knew the outcome because daily she trusted God.
Yes.
You see, Jochebed taught Moses his spiritual and cultural identity early in life. Train up a child in the way that they should go. Don't wait till they're grown and try to tell them the way. Don't wait until they've been tainted by society to try to teach them the way. Jochebed knew her assignment. Jochebed welcomed her assignment. So she taught Moses not just his cultural identity, but his spiritual identity. Early in life, she understood that she was given the opportunity to nurse the child. But according to the times, when the weaning came about, she could have been taken away from Moses. So time was of the essence. So daily, she went and she taught him who he was, not just culturally, but spiritually. I've heard Pastor Bob will say it all the time, talking about my grandma. My grandma would say, "Do you know who you are?" Rhetorical question. She knew the answer, but she wanted to be sure that you knew the answer. She'd run down the lineage and tell you who she was. She'd run down the lineage and tell you who she came from. She'd run down the lineage and tell you who God called you to be. Early in life. Because he teaches these lessons when we're young, so that when we're grown and we're out in the world, the teaching always comes back to us because you know who you are. You see, if Jochebed had any doubt about Moses having a special call, those doubts were destroyed when God saved Moses' life by an Egyptian princess. If she said, "Well, you know, this, I kind of thought the baby was special, but maybe I was a little thrown off." But when she saw an Egyptian princess take her baby and instead of killing him, loved him, she knew then the calling on his life. So if you need proof of how special the spiritual identity of your child is, watch God use your enemy to bless them and allow their identity to come to pass. You want to know if God called them to do it? Watch those that want to stand against it have to get out of the way. You want to know if God called you to do it? Stand flat-footed with no resources and watch him make a way out of nowhere. Right. You want to know if God calls you to do it? Let everybody tell you no, but you still feel the yes of God on the inside. You want to know if God calls you to do it? Lay out your plan and let him make the provision. You want to know if God calls you to do it? Watch him take a ministry from Somerville and bring it to Yemisi. You want to know if God calls you to do it? Watch him take a center in Texas and send him back home to proclaim his word. You want to know if God calls you to do it? Let every opposition stand up against you and let you walk in perfect peace. It's so sweet to trust in Jesus. Just to take him at his word.
Thank you, God.
Just to take him. I want you to understand how profound it is. Just to take him at his word. We don't need miracle signs and wonders. All we need is his word. You see, the miracles come about to prove to the doubting world that he is who he is. But his word confirms for us he's done it before and he can always do it again. You see, Jochebed was on assignment. She couldn't get worried about the riches of Pharaoh. She didn't let her seat in the palace cause her to lose time. She didn't say, "Well, you know what? We made it to the big house, so now we don't got nothing to worry about." Daily, at every opportunity, she was instilling in him his spiritual and his cultural identity. She took every moment as if it was their last together. Because she understood the assignment. You got to make every single moment count. You see, Moses learned his Hebrew history. He became a patriotic person for the people of faith, and he accepted his call to deliver his people.
Yeah.
Because his mother instilled in him exactly who he was. I can hear his mother saying, "Now, when you get out here around these Egyptians, don't you forget who you are." Now, when you get out here and everybody want to proclaim you because they want to talk about your adopted father, don't you forget where you came from. Now, when you get out here and you're amongst them and they're doing what they do, don't you forget the grace and the mercy that God has afforded unto you. You see, Jochebed laid a firm foundation so that when he was turned over to Pharaoh's daughter for the Egyptian training, his foundation was already solidified.
Yes.
There was nothing to worry about. Everything that the Egyptians told him that was contrary to what mama said, he already knew better. How many times do we get in situations? And we kind of feel like we know better, but circumstances in life tell us there's another way. How many times do we find ourselves in situations where we know we shouldn't do it, but there's a chance we can do it and get away with it? You see, Jochebed laid the firm foundation so that there was nothing, that's what you call a woman of faith. She knew he was a child. She knew he could mess up. She knew that the fads were coming. She knew that the pressure was coming. But she said, remember what I taught you. Remember who you are. You see, children must understand who they are and who they belong to before this world has a chance to tear them apart. You see, mama's teaching will keep you on the straight and narrow. And mama's teachings may be a little hard here and there, but the world is going to tell you that you can relax and let down your standards. The world is going to tell you there is another way. The world is going to tell you you don't got to do it like they did it all them years ago. The world is going to tell you there is a new way. But when mama lays the firm foundation, the children, oh, they may veer off course, but they're always going to come back in because the foundation is solid. Now, mothers, I want to give you the cheat code for raising your children. Cheat code number one, learn to let go and let God. A wise woman, you may know it, my mother, told me at my 40th birthday, raising children is like flying a kite.
Yes, they are.
The tighter you hold on to the string, the more they're going to fight back. But when you loosen your grip a little bit, the kite seems to fly high. You see, my mother wanted to protect me from bad decisions. But I had to make my own path and go my own way so that I could have a testimony to share with you on today. I deviated from the path. But the foundation laid by my mother and my grandmother always brought me back in. It brought everything full circle. You see, Jochebed placed her baby in the Nile River in a basket held together by pitch. There were animals, there were gators, there were many things to fear. But she placed the baby in the river with no effort and worry. He could have drowned. Somebody could have found him and killed him. So many things could have happened. But Jochebed had faith that when she released Moses into the Nile, what she was really doing was releasing her baby back into the hands of God. Thy kingdom come, let thy will be done. That's a faith statement. Thy kingdom come, let thy will be done. Not my will, you know, I'd want to just keep the baby and raise him and everything be all right. Not just my will, I'd rather this situation not happen. Not just my will, I'd rather you kill Pharaoh for what he wanted to do. Not my will be done, but thy will be done. She trusted. She let go, and she let God. You see, Pharaoh's daughter was bathing in the Nile River when she found the basket that had Moses in it because Jesus was playing. God was playing chess, okay? So bathing in the Nile River was a spiritual act for the Egyptians. So while she was in this spiritual act and communing and doing that which she could do, along comes this baby. And when she saw the Hebrew baby, it was laid upon her heart to love the baby and not kill the baby. But see, God put her in the sacred river to accomplish his divine task. He'll make a way out of nowhere. He will make your enemy your footstool. All he wants you to do is trust him. Let go and let God. Cheat code number two, remember that God can make your worst enemy your savior.
All right, man.
Pharaoh's daughter deciding to adopt Moses was truly a miracle. She knew what her father said. She knew what was expected. But how could daddy say no when daughter says, I want to keep the baby? The plan was at work. The spirit was moving and in control. It was going from heart to heart, from the heart of the daughter to the heart of the father to show the favor to Moses. A a way was being made out of no way. A sworn enemy became a submissive friend. He will prepare the table before you in the presence of your enemies. How much closer could Moses have gotten to the presence of his enemies? Didn't even know there was a need to worry because his mother had great faith. His mother was a praying woman. His mother made ways out of nowhere. Let me tell you something. You do not stand between a mother and her prayers for her children. You see, I went through a situation in my life of divorce, and it caused me to go back home. And I really didn't want to go back to my grandma's house. But everybody said, just go back to grandma's house. And I got there, and it would be days where I would feel low, and days where I would feel depressed, and days where I didn't want to be bothered. And then I would go and I would lay across grandma's bed. And see, I would remember those days back in 1985 in the summer when we lay across the bed and we would sing. They'll be singing over yonder and singing over there. And when all these singers get together, how are we going to enjoy one another? I didn't understand the songs at that time. All I wanted to do was lay up under my grandma. I was 5 years old at that time. And now at 43 years old, I lay on that bed and I remember these things. You see, then I'll get out of the bed and I'll kneel down at the foot of the bed and I'll say my prayers, and I'm reminded that this is the same spot that my grandma prayed in. And if my grandma prayed in that spot, the residue of those prayers is still in that room. The residue of those prayers is still in that house. The residue of those prayers still has me covered. The residue of those prayers are still working. She was my jockey man. She prayed for me. She made a way out of no way. She never defended her thesis. She never got a college degree. She never had a high school education. She never sat at the feet of Gamaliel, but she kneeled in the presence of the Almighty, and he made a way out of no way. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. I believe in my heart that when she knelt at the foot of that bed, she prayed for me. I believe in my heart that when she knelt at the foot of that bed, she knew that hardship would come. I believe in my heart when she knelt at the foot of that bed that she said, Lord, protect him and Lord, cover him. She made a faith move. There was no logic in it. There was no money in it. There was no last name stamps in it. It was nothing but faith. Don't stand between a mother and her prayers. And God will make your enemy your savior. Proverbs 16 and 7 states, when the Lord takes pleasure in anyone's way, he causes their enemies to make peace with them. When the Lord takes pleasure in anyone's ways, not for the ways of the rich, not the ways of those who live on the right side of the tracks, not the ways of those that have six digits in their 401k. Not the ways of those that have three-piece suits. Not the ways of those that have red-bottom shoes. Not the ways of those that are recognized as the elites. When God takes pleasure in anyone's ways, he causes their enemies to make peace with them. Suddenly, they forget why you're arguing. Better yet, suddenly you forget why you were worried. Suddenly you forget what you're up against. Suddenly all you want to do is spend time in the presence of the Father because he will cause your enemies to give you peace. You were too caught up to seek the peace on your own. But he'll send the peace through your enemy so that you know it was nobody but God. You see, don't worry about that boss that has it out for you. Keep the faith. Don't worry about those family members that ain't talking to you. Keep the faith. Don't worry about that bill collector that keeps calling. Keep the faith. Because God will cause your enemies to make peace with you. Last cheat code. Remember, God rewards faith. He don't reward your money. He don't reward how you shout down the aisle. He don't reward how eloquently you speak in tongues. God rewards faith. We see this over and over in the scripture. God rewarding those who trust her. Because Jochebed made a faith move, she got her baby back.
Yeah.
And she got paid to raise.
Yeah.
Because she didn't operate in logic. She operated in faith. Logically, she could have said, I'll send the baby halfway across the world, put him on a camel's back, and you know, he can go over to my great grandmom and them out there in the country, and Pharaoh will never find him. That's not what she did. She stayed in the kitchen. She stayed in the heat. She stayed in the line of fire because she knew if she made a faith move, it would activate God and God's covenant.
Yes.
You see, God wants us to trust him because when we trust him and we have faith, that is when he responds. He ain't moving when you pray so eloquently that it can be on national TV. He ain't moving because you got 2,000 likes on your last post. He ain't moving because you are a social media influencer. He moves when you operate out of faith. Sometimes God brings the situation as nasty as he brings it, as dirty as he brings it, as hard as he brings it. So you have to say, nobody but God. Make a faith move and see what he does. As we go through the rest of this day, remember Jochebed, and remember that she was a steward over the gifts of her children. I want you to think about your children. I want you to think about their uniqueness. I want you to think about how special they are to you. But then I want you to remember that there's a calling on their life. And you mothers have the opportunity to be the steward over that calling on their life. I want you to look at your children that are wayward and far away from where you want them to be, but I want you to see them saved and set free. I want you to look at your bank account that has no money in it, and I want you to see yourself as a lender to many nations. I want you to look at your family that's spread far apart, and I want you to see everybody coming back together. I want you to look at your job where you're barely making ends meet, but I want you to see God making ways out of nowhere. I want you to look at your household that seems to be a broken family, but I want you to see God as the glue that holds it all together. You are a steward over the gift within your children. The world's going to tell you they're disruptive. The world's going to tell you they're dishonest. The world's going to tell you that they ain't ever going to be nothing. But God told you that you are a steward over the gift within them. Don't look with your sight, because your sight's going to miss it. But look with faith, and you're going to see it. There's always a ram in the bush. You just got to have the vision to see it and the ear to hear when God talks to you. Be a good steward over that which God